we're going to calculate the blast radius of an atomic bomb. Fortunately, without dropping any atomic bombs, because that's one way to do it. And that was exactly how the US military were doing this 1940s Manhattan Project, Los Alamos, all of that part of history, interesting things happening in the physics and maths world. The US military were doing all these experiments and were making measurements of, as they changed the size of the bomb or certain weather conditions, as to how fast that sort of mushroom cloud would expand. Of course, quite useful information if you're dropping a bomb, you know, potentially near your own soldiers, or there are certain areas you want to avoid, you want to have an idea how much that's going to spread out. Pretty important information. And as because atomic bombs were so new back in the 1940s, we didn't really know this. So it did require this like trial and error approach, or it required the clever mathematical approach. And so this is the story of G.I. Taylor, a British mathematician who was asked by the UK government to help out during the World Wars. So he actually helped out in World War I and World War II. In World War II, he was sent over as part of the British delegation to go and visit the test site, visit the Manhattan Project. And he actually saw the first ever blast, the Trinity test in 1945. He actually witnessed one of, I think, there are only 10 people that were there, and one of them was this mathematician, G.I. Taylor. What he did, using some photographs taken from the explosion, was actually calculate the formula for the blast radius of the atomic bomb, which at the time was a US military secret. So D.I. Taylor did these calculations and just published this in mathematical research journals, and it was quoted as pretty embarrassing for the US military at the time, because this was like their most closely guarded military secret about the inner workings of an atomic bomb. And then this British mathematician comes along and just kind of, you know, does a pretty straightforward calculation, as we'll see, to just get the answers, basically. So it's a very, very cool story, and also uses possibly my favorite tool in all of applied maths, which is that of scaling analysis. It's very, very applied maths, should stress this, because you kind of go into physics and think about what is happening in a problem to then write down the important parameters in your problem and then combine them in such a way to get the answer you want. So you do have to have that sort of very applied physicist-like mind to be able to use this, but it's such a good tool because you can calculate the formula for an atomic bomb without setting off a single atomic bomb. And so the way Taylor did it, first of all, what factors are going to influence the spreading rate of our bomb blast? First thing, at least that came to my mind and to Taylor's mind, was the energy. You have a bigger bomb, it's going to blow up more stuff. It's reasonably straightforward to see. So we don't know whether that relationship is linear or anything yet, but we know that the energy of the bomb is going to affect that blast radius. So we're going to write down energy. We're going to label E. That's definitely one of the parameters that's going to be in our problem. Now, the other one that's reasonably obvious is time. If you've just set your bomb off, it's not gone very far. If you wait a few seconds, it's gone a lot further. We're trying to work out the radius of the blast. So as time increases, the radius will certainly increase. So we're going to have time, which we label with T. And now the sort of real fluid dynamics and physics comes into it. And Taylor was a fluid dynamicist in Cambridge. And this is where this really helped him, because he thought about the problem as follows. You have, as the bomb detonates, you have a huge amount of energy being released from a tiny, tiny volume. And so you have a very almost instantaneous explosion from tiny, tiny volume to massive amount of energy. And what that's going to do is create a massive, massively high pressure within that explosion, that sort of cloud of your bomb. So you can kind of think of it as, if this is the sort of initial explosion, in here, if you take this to be pressure, this is really high inside this region. And as soon as you get out of the bomb region, the atmospheric pressure is really low. And you almost have like a, what we would call a shock. This is where the term shockwave comes from, the shockwave of a blast. Because here you've got super high pressure from this giant explosion, and here you've just got atmospheric pressure. And these are like orders of magnitude different. What this tells you is not what is important in the problem, but what is not important. And this is the sort of the fluid dynamics, the physical intuition of these problems. And Taylor was a fluid dynamicist, that's why he knew this. So because this is so high and this is so small, the pressure of the air is not going to play a role in the expansion of the bomb. So whether it's high pressure or low pressure weather system, it's not actually going to matter. So it tells you that pressure is crossed off. If the air pressure isn't important, then you think, well, what other properties of the air are going to affect the spread of the bomb? You would expect there to be a difference in the spreading rate depending on the fluid or the air that you're moving through. The other possibilities are density and maybe temperature. We have an equation relating these two. It's called the ideal gas law. And you often will model air as such. And it says that these two, if the pressure is constant or negligible, these two just depend on each other. So he just picked density. So this sort of physical intuition told you pressure didn't matter, and that meant it had to be density. That was the key insight that came from Taylor being a fluid dynamicist.
The pressure of this atmosphere doesn't matter, but doesn't this pressure matter?
This pressure will absolutely matter, but this will basically be controlled by the energy. This is the thing with scaling analysis, and it's a very good question, because there are so many different things you can pick. And sometimes it is almost like black magic that you pick the right ones and put them together in such a way. So I'm sure there are many, many examples of scaling analysis not working, but this just happens to be like possibly my favorite example of it working and discovering a military secret. So we've got energy, we've got time, and then we've got density. Density of the outside air, which we label with rho. The scaling analysis is what comes in here, because what you do is you look at the units of your three parameters. We denote this with a square bracket in maths. So let's start with time, because that's easy. The units of time are time, seconds. And I'm going to just call it a time, which is a T. Now, energy. The way I remember the units of energy is to think of, let's take my favorite energy, kinetic energy. So kinetic energy is a half times mass times velocity squared. So the units are a mass times a velocity squared. Velocity is distance divided by time. So that's distance over time squared. So I now have a mass, a length squared, over a time squared for the units for energy. I've got just a T for time, and density is a mass per length cubed, because we're working in 3D, kilograms per meter cubed, for example. So we've now got the units of energy, the units of time, and the units of density. And now the scaling analysis argument is to say, well, I have determined through knowledge of physics and fluid dynamics, as Taylor did, that these three are the most important parameters that I think control the blast radius. So if I can arrange these in such a way that I get rid of the mass and get rid of time from the units, and all I'm left with is a length, that must be the radius. Because what other possible length could it be? That's the kind of argument. And then of course you have to validate this and test this with some amount of experiments. So you don't need to do hundreds like the US military, but Taylor happened to have one or two photographs from that one test he went to, and he checked it against that and showed that it was correct. So what we just have to do now is combine the three sets of units in such a way that we just get length. So we've got a mass, a length, and a time. So I think if we start by removing mass, so if we do energy E divided by density rho, then that is equal to, square brackets for units, m L squared over T squared, divided by the density, puts an m on the bottom and an L cubed on top. So the m's cancel, and so this is equal to L to the 5 over T squared. So now we've got rid of mass, which is very good, but we still have time. So we get rid of time by introducing T. So we just are going to have to multiply on the top by time squared, and that gives us now, with the time squared on the top, we just have L to the 5, because it will cancel. And finally, this is a length to the power 5, but we just want a radius, which is just L, so we just take the whole thing to the power of 1/5. So if we want our time-dependent radius of an atomic bomb, the radius of an atomic bomb is proportional to the energy to the 1/5, the time after explosion to the 2/5, and the air density to the minus 1/5. And that right there was the most closely guarded secret in US military in the 1940s.
Had the US military figured it out with mathematics, or had they just used a number of tests and sort of, you know, guessed roughly?
So if you were doing this experimentally, which is what they did, you would do lots of different explosions, and you would take measurements at different times as the thing is exploding and expanding. You'd do it on different days with different air densities, and you'd use different sized bombs. And you'd have all these data points, and then you do sort of try and find a scaling that makes the data collapse into a straight line. That's generally how you do applied maths research today. That's how I did my experiments, doing my research, in fact. So you just get lots of data points and try and plug it all together, and then sort of, it's kind of trial and error, and then suddenly it perfectly fits this pattern.
And Taylor was able to check he got it right because he had a few pictures from the Trinity test,
yes,
didn't he?
Yes, yes. He did. He had these two pictures. He actually published them in a magazine when he released this paper. He published these two images. And so he could check this against these actual images to check the radius. And of course, what we are missing here is there's going to be a constant here. So this is proportional to. So the units match up, but you can still have a number in this gap. And now that's the kind of thing you need to do experiments to get. And Taylor only had the one to compare to. And so I think he was trying to estimate the size of the bomb dropped in this Trinity test in 1945. And he believed it was 20 kilotons. Sorry, he believed it was 22 kilotons. And the actual size was 20. Which, given the sort of, like, it's pretty good, let's be honest. Given that, you know, he didn't have access to highly classified US military secrets. He was able to get within a 10% accuracy the size of the bomb that was dropped in that first ever nuclear test.
This isn't going to help you build an atomic bomb. This is just going to give you an idea how devastating they could be.
Absolutely. So this would be one of the first things, given some new weapon or some new, even sort of like a new source of energy, one of the first things you would want to do would be to try it at different values of energy, different sizes, different densities, and see what happens. Sort of before you were able to actually use it safely. Well, I guess a bomb's not really safe.
In a controlled way.
In a controlled way, thank you. Without unintended circumstances, you would need to know this kind of information. So this was, as I said, this was literally done based on the first ever detonation of an atomic bomb.
Is this constant, this unknown number here, dependent on the type of bomb? Or would a TNT be different to an atomic bomb? Or?
I believe so. That's the sort of the limitation of the scaling analysis. Whilst you can get which parameters are important and the powers of those parameters, you can never get that constant.
But once you've got the constant, it works for all atomic bombs.
Yeah, there's going to be some error. Absolutely going to be some error. But yes, once you have that constant, it hopefully would hold for a particular, at least a particular type of atomic bomb. If you had the same bomb and you dropped it and then you doubled your energy, this would predict how much more the radius would be, and you would absolutely expect that to follow.
What does it tell us?
Well, time is certainly increasing the most in the sense of it has the highest power. If time doubles versus energy double or density doubling, you're going to see the biggest change being in time. But what it does tell us is as you increase the energy, the radius will increase. But it's also telling you here, if you were to go from E to E squared, you're only going to get quite a small increase in your radius. So this 1/5 is sort of saying that you really have to ramp up the energy to get that large radius, where, you know, compared to this being a larger power, because it's quite a small power. And because the density is negative, that's on the denominator. So as the density gets higher, the radius decreases. And that's always a good sanity check for these things making sense. If the energy goes up, you expect a bigger bomb. If you wait longer, you expect a bigger radius. And if you increase the density of the air, so you imagine there's more water in the air, it's like thicker. It's harder for the explosion to move through thicker air. So you would expect it to shrink. So there's always that nice, as I said, a sanity check that it does make physical sense, and mathematically the units balance, the scaling works, and then you would then need to do some at least one experiment to get a grasp on that number. But for the US, so the way you would think about it is the density of the air is reasonably constant. Say you're dropping the bomb in New Mexico. The air density in the summer will be approximately the same across the summer period. So you know that. The time, that just will constantly increase. So the question would then be, say you wanted a bomb such that within 2 seconds of it being dropped, it had destroyed a 1 kilometer radius area. You then plug in 1 kilometer as your radius. You say, I want within 2 seconds it to be gone. I plug in my air density. It tells you the size of the bomb you have to drop to do that damage. So it really is quite valuable information if you're trying to do like a controlled sort of targeted bomb.
Releasing energy, and it produces 2 neutrons, each of which go on to react or to split other atoms of plutonium. So you get a chain reaction, and the explosion just builds up and up and up.